In the previous video, we talked about what Hyper-V is, and there's little doubt in my mind that you guys listening to these videos won't decide to use it. So with that in mind, we're going to see how we can install the product. Now in this video, and the next one for that matter, where we install Hyper-V on a server core server, these videos are going to be very short and sweet, since I'd rather just show you guys how to install Hyper-V now, and we can do that really quickly, and then we'll move on to the longer, more in-depth videos where we're going to do all of the cool configuration type stuff. Now remember, in order to install Hyper-V though, you will require a 64-bit CPU with virtualization capabilities like we discussed in the first video in this series, and you're also going to have a 64-bit edition of Windows 2008 as well. Now another thing I should make clear though is just because we're saying you need to have a 64-bit CPU and a 64-bit copy of Windows 2008, it doesn't mean that you can't create 32-bit guest virtual machines. You certainly can do that. It just means that the host itself must all be 64-bit. So to recap, if you want to install a 32-bit version of Windows XP, for example, there's no problem. You could do that. It's just that the host, the physical server, the one that we're actually going to install Hyper-V on, it must be using 64-bit version of Windows 2008. So with that in mind, I'm actually remote desktoped, if there's such a word, remote desktoped. Well, I have a remote desktop connection, maybe that sounds better. I have a remote desktop connection to a Dell notebook here, which is running Windows Server 2008. The 64-bit edition, of course, and this machine is part of the jorkus.com domain. Now, I've also given this server the host name of Hyper-V, and I'd have to say that, in theory, giving this machine a name of Hyper-V sounded logical. After all, we're going to be seeing how to install and work with Hyper-V, but the more I think about it, it might be a little confusing having the same name as the product. But there's really only a couple of minor spots where a new player to this might be a little confused, so I'll do my best to deal with all that for you. So, the first thing we need to do is fire up the Server Manager console, which is what I have open here, but we can get to that by clicking the little server management icon here down in the bottom left corner. And up the top left here, we'll need to expand, or rather click on, roles. Now you'll note here that since this is a new server, we don't have any roles defined yet. Hyper-V is going to be our first role, so we'll need to click the Add Roles link. This will start up the Add Role Wizard, which you've no doubt seen before, so we'll click Next. And we'll place a check next to the Hyper-V role. And we'll click Next. Now we'll get our typical introduction to our role, in this case Hyper-V, telling us what it is, and it reminds us that we might need to go into our BIOS on this machine in order to set it up so it can support virtualization. Or in other words, we need to turn on those virtualization features for our CPU that we talked about in our introduction video. Alright, we can ignore that. We'll click Next. Then we'll need to choose which network card, or network cards if you have more than one, which network card do we want to allow Hyper-V to use for when our virtual machines require network access. So obviously, these virtual machines that we're going to build on this host, they're going to need to connect to the internet or connect to other machines, you know, they need network access somehow. Their data is going to have to be sent through a real network card on this physical server that we're installing Hyper-V on right now. So we'll need to choose a network card here. Now, since I only have a single card, that's all we can see, just the one card here. So that's what we'll choose. We'll check the box here and we'll click Next. And that's it. We'll click Install and then Hyper-V will begin installing on this machine. Now, it'll probably take about a minute or so to fully install, so rather than waiting around, we'll pause the video here and we'll come back in about a minute. Okay, Hyper-V has installed, and as the message here tells us, we will need to restart our server for the installation to complete. In fact, it's going to need to restart a couple of times, so we'll do that now. We'll click Close, and we'll reboot this machine, and we'll come back shortly. Well, we've just rebooted our server, and it tells us that Hyper-V was installed successfully, and that's great. What we wanted to see here was this green tick. Now, it also tells us that in order to add virtual machines to Hyper-V, we'll need to open up the Hyper-V page in Server Manager. So we'll click Close. Now we'll expand Server Manager and we'll expand Roles, then Hyper-V, And that'll connect us to the local Hyper-V server, which in my case, of course, is just called Hyper-V, which is the name of my server. Don't confuse it with Hyper-V itself. Hyper-V here in this case is just the name, the host name of my server. So the Hyper-V console's interface and all its glory is really only this two-paned console in the middle. We've got a section here which will show us all of our virtual machines. Smack bang in the middle of the console here, we'll be able to see any snapshots that we might have created, and we're going to talk about those later on in another video. And right down the bottom here is a screenshot of what our virtual machine looks like when we created it and any notes we've got about that virtual machine. So over in the right here, we've got a couple of different sections, although at this point we can only see one of them. In this top section here is where we can configure settings that relate to our Hyper-V server itself. So this is going to affect the running of Hyper-V. And at the bottom here, once we've created a virtual machine and once we've selected it over here in the middle, we'll be able to see any settings that relate to whatever virtual machine we've selected. And all of these settings here are also available when we right-click on a virtual machine itself. But we're going to see all that as we start working with our virtual machines in a later video. So now that Hyper-V is installed, let's move on. Let's move forward in this series of videos and we'll take a good look at what Hyper-V has to offer. So we hope you've enjoyed this video and we'd like to thank you for watching.